This is a national emergency. Important details will follow. The emergency alert system has been activated.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people, for I have complete confidence in the response and dedication of our citizens whenever they are fully informed.
This video is based upon our research into the power structure behind the push for global government. The formation of a global government would require the cooperation of a large group of people from many nationalities and backgrounds. An organizational structure would be required to guarantee fairness, establish hierarchy, and avert betrayal. Such an organization would need to demonstrate a rich history of trust and cooperation between members. Prevailing thoughts on this subject are that such an organization would have its roots in Zionism, Satanism, or Freemasonry. Let us first consider Zionism, which seems an unlikely choice for the following reasons. The unfolding world government requires the full cooperation of many different ethnic groups. However, history has shown that different ethnic groups rarely trust each other enough to willingly allow one ethnic group to dominate the others and lead them in a particular direction. For instance, you wouldn't find early Irish American immigrants handing over the reins of power to Italian American immigrants or Jewish American immigrants, and vice versa. The flaunting of ethnic differences immediately sets people at odds with each other. Typically, they do not form close bonds and higher levels of trust. For a Zionist world government to work, many different ethnic groups would need to empower a tiny group of Zionists, most of whom are Jews, and in essence relinquish their destiny to this highly ethnic group. As many of you are aware, Zionism is a nationalistic idea which supports a Jewish nation state and the territory defined as the Land of Israel. Pro-world government ethnic groups in China, India, and Pakistan would have to buy into Zionism to a large extent and base their trust upon relationships emanating from such a belief. And if you believe that Zionists are dominating and controlling the largest Eastern nations, it is important to consider that countries such as China, India, and Pakistan have sizable nuclear arsenals. Could these nations be bullied into submission by a scant few followers of Zionism? And if they could, would the leaders of these Eastern nations continue to enthusiastically support the idea of world government and champion a global banking structure run by a dominant group of Zionists? Speaking from a purely historical standpoint, it remains highly unlikely. And yet, the leaders of the Eastern nations are in full support of the emerging world government and its banking structure. Some say that Freemasonry is controlled by Zionists. If this were the case, Freemasonry would surely be forced to carry out the agenda of Zionism. And because the agenda of Zionism is very particular to Israel, it would be obvious to all ethnic groups within Freemasonry that an agenda of Israeli favoritism was being carried out. And so we would arrive back at the problem of Zionism's unlikely ability to unite different ethnic groups under a world government. Do not misunderstand our position. We feel that Zionism is a legitimate problem. We realize that Israel receives special treatment from many countries. And we are fully aware that Israeli agents helped carry out the 9/11 false flag attacks. However, we are not convinced that Zionism is the root of world government. There's a good possibility that many globalists are pretending to be Jews and/or Zionists so they can hide behind the anti-Semitic defense. Furthermore, real Jews and Zionists who advocate world government are likely utilizing the anti-Semitic defense as well. Using sympathy to gain support has worked wonders as a psychological operation, and we see no reason that those behind a world government would not employ such a tactic. In our quest to uncover the root of global government, the next possibility we might consider is Satanism, which has its roots in the Abrahamic religions of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Although Satanism has come to encompass a variety of New Age philosophies, it can never truly escape the confines of the religious structure from which it sprang. Surely there have been some moderately successful attempts to morph Satanism into atheism, but because its origins lie in the Abrahamic religions, it does not easily translate into other world religions and belief systems. Therefore, it is unlikely that a belief in Satanism would unite a Chinese Taoist, Japanese Buddhist, or Indian Hindu under the banner of world government. However, many world leaders with these Eastern religious backgrounds are deeply involved in the push for a world government. These men and women could be hiding a satanic belief, but again, it remains unlikely. So, which organization assures its members that they will not be betrayed at some point in the future, or hung out to dry like so many Middle Eastern despots? Our third option is Freemasonry. Unlike the last two possibilities, modern Freemasonry is an all-inclusive organization. Atheists are permitted to join through the Grand Orient de France branch of Masonry. Other Masonic lodges merely require the belief in any supreme being. Freemasonry spans a variety of ethnic groups. Historically, it has fostered trust and cooperation between members of different cultures, races, and religions. There are Masonic lodges in many parts of the world, including Europe, the Middle East, China, India, the Americas, and Africa. Lodges even exist within the military hierarchy of many countries. For instance, the U.S. government allows Masonic lodges within all branches of the military. Masonic symbols and landmarks are strewn across almost every continent. From the Masonic obelisks in Israel, Paris, Washington, D.C., Vatican City, and London, to the Freemason Rothschild-funded Israeli Supreme Court, with its massive Masonic pyramid complete with an all-seeing eye at the pinnacle, to the Masonic Temple in Forest Hills, Ohio, which was made possible by Rockefeller estate donations, to the lodges located within the former British colonies of Hong Kong and India, to the Masonic layout of Washington, D.C., the Mason-donated Statue of Liberty, and the symbology on American money itself, no one can deny that Freemasonry has infected almost every country on the planet. Based upon such criteria, Freemasonry could easily be the organization behind the push for world government. There is also abundant historical evidence that the Freemasons have used their power for nefarious purposes. Freemasons were behind the murder of William Morgan, the Jack the Ripper murder cover-up, the French Revolution, the plot to kill Archduke Ferdinand, plans for world wars, judicial and police corruption in the UK, and the mafia-related activities of the P2 Masonic Lodge, to name a few. Interestingly enough, the ruling body of Freemasonry never accepts responsibility for any wrongdoing. Instead, they devote all of their energies to deflecting bad press and denying involvement in any activity deemed harmful to the organization. Masons have proven to be some of the most accomplished liars on the face of the earth. Freemason oaths to aid and assist any distressed Freemason and never reveal anything related to the Brotherhood when given under a Masonic sign, except in matters of murder or treason, are mostly to blame for their numerous deceptions. It is important to remember that Freemasons did absolutely no charitable work until after Freemasonry was banned in several U.S. states around the year 1830 for the organization's involvement in murder and conspiracy. During this time, American Freemasons essentially went into hiding and voluntarily closed lodges to avoid condemnation from a rightfully angry citizenry. In 1870, the Freemasons quietly reemerged and created the Shriners, whose focus was to be fun, fellowship, and charity. The Shriners branch of Freemasonry was designed to put a good face on the recently besmirched organization, and nothing more. Today, the Freemasons continue with their nefarious plans, while using the Shriners Children's Hospital as a defense mechanism. In the end, this strategy is no different than the mob operating a soup kitchen to garner support. It is both deceptive and pathetic. Based upon years of research and a careful process of elimination, we are now confident that Freemasonry is the driving force behind a world dictatorship. We are also convinced that there are no good Freemasons. All members are fully aware of the organization's many trespasses over the centuries, as well as their treacherous oaths, yet they refuse to resign. Unlike most taxpayers who only pay a fraudulent government to avoid lengthy prison sentences, all members of Freemasonry willingly donate money to the Freemason organization and are therefore complicit in the activities of the whole. We encourage the viewer to produce anti-Masonic videos, websites, and spread this message by word of mouth. You may also wish to hold protests outside your local lodge. Freemasons hate bad publicity, and they deserve every bit of it. Your hard work and dedication can bring about the downfall of the abominable Freemason Mafia. We are seeking a worldwide ban against Freemasonry and life sentences for all 5 million or so members who refuse to resign. A Masonic database of names and faces must be compiled. These men and women must not escape justice.
Called the death panel, and you're not supposed to have that discussion.
Anthony Gates actually brags he's doing God's work. The boss of Goldman Sachs said exactly the same thing while sending millions into starvation. What the heck is going on?
His father was one of the main grandfathers of the whole entire eugenics movement here inside the United States, and it's still going strong today.
My dad was head of Planned Parenthood, and it was very controversial.
And Bill Gates is here once again pushing the GMOs and everything else that is also reducing the population, because that's what he says. If we do a good enough job with vaccinations and everything, we'll be able to reduce the population. The polio vaccines now are the number one cause of polio. There's no question that Bill Gates is not doing God's work. And if he is doing God's work, I would ask, which God?
Yeah, how have we moved to open plans to take away our water, hoarding food, and population controls?
They speak to us as if we are peon peasants in medieval times, and they are the kings, queens, and nobles. Why do they target the low-income portions?
Yeah, May 25th, over 2 million people across 48 states and 6 continents marched against Monsanto. What do you make of the company refusing to talk to us because we covered the march?
They can't stand up to the facts. They wouldn't come on this show. I would love to debate a Monsanto employee and show them that email. I mean, what would they say? They have nothing. They go into these poor communities and then, of course, reduced yields. So what happens to these farmers? They end up killing themselves by drinking the biopesticides that Monsanto gave them. So every 30 minutes, while we've been talking, someone has killed themselves.
Execs now boast about infertility from GMOs, hoard food, and say water shouldn't be a human right. Monsanto has publicly stated it wants to control 100% of the world's food supply. The government isn't stopping them, so who will?
Today, I've got to share something with you that I found. While going through some of my things, I found a box of my grandfather's stuff that I'd never opened yet that said on the front of it, Masonic material. Now, as many as you know, I tell everybody about how I come from a Masonic family. Well, here's some junk that I found that they've left behind. Oh my goodness, Knights of the Columbus Oath extract the fourth degree. In the presence of Almighty God, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and the Saint John the Baptist, and the Holy... My goodness. Like I said, I'm reading a very old... piece of paper here, and some of these words are kind of hard to make out. It's even moth-eaten a little. It's been in storage for probably longer than I've been alive. I'm 31. Anyway, this is from the Knights of Columbus Oath Extract, 4th degree. Ah, their name, now in the presence of Almighty God, the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Blessed Saint John the Baptist, the Holy Apostle Saint Peter, and Saint Paul, and all the Saints, sacred hosts of heaven, and to you, my ghostly father, the superior general of the Society of Jesus, founded by Saint Ignatius, will let you. In the pontification of Paul the Third, and continued in the present, do by the womb something out of the matrix of God and the God of Jesus Christ, declare and swear that His Holiness the Pope is Christ, Vice-Regent, and is the true head of the Catholic or Universal Church throughout the earth. You know what? This is the same wicked trash that Billy Graham preaches. I bet you anything that he is a Freemason. He preaches their doctrine right here. Anyway, and that by virtue of the keys of binding and losing, giving His Holiness, but my Savior, Jesus Christ, He hath power to depose heretical kings, princes, states, commonwealths, and governments that may be destroyed. Therefore, to the uttermost of my power, I will defend His doctrine and His Holiness right and custom against all usurpers of heretical or Protestant authority, whatever, especially the Lutheran Church of Germany, Holland, Denmark, Sweden, and Norway, and now pretend authority of the churches of England and Scotland, and the branches of some now established in Ireland, and the continent of America, and elsewhere, an odd adherence in regard that they may be absurd and heretical, opposing the Sacred Mother Church of Rome. I do now denounce and disown any allegiance as due to any heretical king, prince, or state named Protestant or liberals or obedience to any of their laws, magistrates, or officers. I do further declare that the doctrine of the churches of England and Scotland, of the Calvinists, Huguenots, and the other named Protestants or Masons to be damnable. Yeah. The doctrine of the Masons is damnable, and they themselves to be damned who will not forsake the same. It's moth-eaten here, but I think what it says is I do solemnly swear will help assist in something other or any of his holy agents in any place where I should be, in Switzerland, Germany, Holland, Ireland, or America, or any other kingdom or territory I shall come to, and do my utmost to extirpate the heretical Protestant or Masonic doctrines and to destroy all their pretended powers, legal or otherwise. I do further promise and declare that notwithstanding I am dispensed with to assume any religion heretical for the propagation of the Mother Church's interest, to keep secret and private all her agents' counsels from time to time as they entrust me, and not divulge directly or indirectly by word, writing, or circumstance whatever, but to execute all that should be proposed, given in charge, or discovered unto me by you, my ghostly father. I do further promise and declare that I will have no opinion or will of my own. Oh, look, they promise to be a zombie. Even as a corpse or a cadaver, current dot, carry on dot character, but will hastily obey each and every command that I may receive from the superior in the militia of the Pope and of Jesus Christ. That I will go to any part of the world, whithersoever I may be sent, to the frozen regions of the north, jungles of India, to the centers of civilization of Europe, or to the wild haunts of the barbarous savages of America, without murmuring or repining, and will be submissive in all things whatsoever is communicated to me. I do further promise and declare that I will, whenever opportunity presents, make and wage relentless war, secretly and openly, against all heretics, Protestants, and Masons, as I am directed to do, to extract them from the face of the whole earth, and that I will hang, burn, waste, bull, fry, strangle, and bury alive these infamous heretics, rip up the stomachs, wombs of their women, and crush their infants' heads against the wall in order to annihilate their execrable race. Let me just tell you right now. So, a person that gets into the fourth degree, into the Scottish Rite, so they swear an oath to kill people's children. And these kind of people that swear these oaths like this, it is untelling what they would do to your children, but yet, you're supposed to just let Masons go and take care of them in Sunday school. And really? That when the same cannot be done openly, I will secretly use the poisonous cup, the strangulation cord, and the steel of the poniard, and the leaden bullet, regardless of honor, rank, dignity, or authority of the persons whatever may be their station in life, either public or private, as I at any time may be directed to do so by any agent of the Pope or Superior of the Brotherhood of the Holy Father of the Society of Jesus. In confirmation of what I hereby dedicate my life, soul, and all corporal powers, and with the dagger I now receive, I will subscribe my name written in my own blood, testimony thereof, and I should prove false, and should I prove false or witness in my detrimation, may my brothers and fellow soldiers of the militia of the Pope cut off my hands and feet, and my throat from ear to ear, my belly open, and sulfur burn therein, with all the punishment that can be inflicted upon me on the earth, and my soul shall be tortured by demons in eternal hell forever. Wow. That I will always vote for a Knight of Columbus in the preference to a Protestant, especially a Mason, and that I will leave my party to do so, that if two Catholics are on the ticket, I will satisfy myself which is the better supporter of the Mother Church and vote accordingly. That I will not deal with or employ a Protestant if my power to deal with or employ a Catholic. That I will place Catholic girls in Protestant families, that a weekly report may be made of the inner movement of the heretics. that I will provide myself with arms and ammunition, that I may be in readiness, that when the word is passed or I am commanded to defend in the church, either as an individual or with the militia of the Pope, all of which I, their name, do swear by the blessed Trinity and the blessed sacrament which I am now to receive and perform, and on part to keep this my oath, in testimony hereof, I take this most holy and blessed sacrament of the Eucharist. Are you hearing this stuff? Of the Eucharist? Witness of the same further with my name written within the point of his dagger, dipped in my own blood and sealed in the face of this holy sacrament, taken from the Congressional Record of February 15th, 1923. So somebody wants to tell you how Christian like Freemasonry is, just tell them they're a liar. Because they are. Or they just don't know what they're talking about. It's one or the other. Because you don't have to join the lodge to find this stuff out. Now I want to tell you people something right now. This right here with this oath on here that my grandfather was learning and swore, okay? This was not found on the internet. This was not taken from anywhere on the internet. When this copy was made, nobody was using the internet. It wasn't about, except for whatever the military had. So, there is a huge problem here.
I have two words for you, predator drones. You will never see it coming. You think I'm joking?
And I would see these states in which there were these crisscross patterns, and they were very tight patterns, and these geometrical shapes where it was obvious they were, it was a purposeful covering of the atmosphere with these patterns. And the trails were so long. Well, now, you know, we're starting to see them in my state. And as I look at them, they go from horizon to horizon. Well, you know, I've been alive long enough to know that jets never did that in the past. And I see the same patterning effect. In other words, they're crisscrossing. It's an obvious pattern. And so I looked into the literature and some of the reports and YouTube videos, and they were saying that they were dropping one of the ingredients was aluminum. Well, I had done a fair amount of writing and research on the effect of aerosolized chemicals in the nose when you breathe them. And what we knew was that these particles tend to travel along the olfactory nerves, which are the smell nerves in the nose, and it travels directly to the part of the brain that has to do with memory and emotions, the hippocampus, the entorhinal area, and the prefrontal cortex, and that you can trace these chemicals traveling along that nerve and depositing in this area of the brain. The other thing that was known is that if you aerosolize aluminum, it's one of the metals that passes very easily along this track and directly into the brain, so it bypasses the blood-brain barrier and goes directly into the brain and accumulates. Well, if you do it in animals, it produces lesions or damage in that area of the brain, and the animal will begin to show changes of memory and learning and emotional changes. When we look at people who have Alzheimer's disease, ironically, the highest concentration of aluminum in the brain is that same entry point, which is called the entorhinal cortex, and the levels continue to accumulate. So we have compelling evidence that aerosolized aluminum alone will enter the brain and produce damage to that critical area of the brain. The worst of all is the nanosize. Now, nanosize means you make it such a small particle that it easily penetrates skin, it penetrates barriers in the body that normally metals cannot pass through. When you nanosize them, produce these incredibly small particulate matter, it passes very easily. So when you nanosize aluminum and you use it in these aerosols through the nasal passages, it enters the brain in very high concentrations. And they find that the nanosize aluminum in the brain is infinitely more toxic. Now, one of the toxic reactions to aluminum is intense inflammation and activation of cells in the brain that are the immune cells called microglia. Aluminum is a very potent activator of these immune cells, and that triggers the release of a powerful substance called glutamate, which is an excitotoxin that causes cells to die from an excitatory mechanism, kind of complex mechanism, but it is a combination of inflammation and excitotoxicity. And I coined the term in the medical literature called immunoexcitotoxicity to describe that process. So we know that occurs. We know it occurs very easily. Now, the reports are coming out now that what they're spraying is nano-sized aluminum, and the idea is the concept of preventing global warming. And they nano-size the aluminum so it'll stay in the upper atmosphere longer, supposedly as a reflective compound, metal. The problem with that, even from a climatologic description, is that if you make it into cirrus-like clouds rather than reflecting it upward and out of the atmosphere, it reflects the heat downward and actually causes global warming. So they, you know, you could envision that they're doing this on purpose to make the atmosphere heat up so they can see the atmosphere is warming up. But what I'm concerned about mainly is the medical effect, and that's because of this very strong connection between aluminum passing through this pathway into the brain is so strongly connected with Alzheimer's disease and other diseases of memory. If you're aerosolizing this and spraying literally tons of it over the world, and people are constantly breathing that aerosolized nano-sized aluminum, which will easily penetrate filters in your air conditioning system, enter your home. So you're breathing it 24 hours a day, producing high levels of aluminum in this part of the brain, and the consequences could be absolutely devastating. It could cause a huge increase in Alzheimer's disease and inflammatory neurological disorders. Now, I watched a YouTube, which was a geoengineering conference that the government had put on. And in the conference, one of the questions somebody in the audience asked, well, what is the medical effect of spraying aluminum in the atmosphere? And the speaker said, well, we don't really know, but we're in the process of researching that. Well, of course, that was an absolute lie. We do know what it does.
Right.
But the fact that they were admitting that in fact they were going to spray, they gave it in the future tense, that they were going to spray aluminum. The evidence now from the examination by biologists and scientists around the world is that the aluminum level in the lakes and streams and trees and is increasing enormously. Some areas have incredible elevations of aluminum in the groundwater and in the vegetation. So if this indeed is happening, we're looking at a medical catastrophe that's worldwide.
Well, you know, and one of the main things that bothers me about that is we see the same thing with the vaccines. You know, we're going to put all these vaccines together and inject them into your child. Well, have we tested that? No, we don't know what's going on. To already implement this program and have it going out, literally, I mean, I live in Missouri, and I can tell you, on any given day, it's chemtrail after chemtrail after chemtrail. Just, it's ridiculous. It covers the entire sky on certain days. And not knowing what the health impacts are, that's criminal.
Well, it is, and I've been on several programs, and that's what I wide scale, and you're inducing a number of diseases just from breathing it. I mean, within the lungs, you can produce asthma, you can produce chronic lung disease. People who have pre-existing chronic lung disease will precipitously get worse, because aluminum, as it enters the epithelium of the lungs, is going to produce intense inflammatory reactions, and that's going to produce a worsening of their pulmonary conditions. Also, the aluminum is absorbed into the bloodstream, can be deposited in the heart. People with heart failure would get worse. People with hypertension would get worse. Numerous diseases could be precipitated and worsened by such an insane policy. But it is criminal. It's a criminal act.
Yeah, no doubt.
No one was asked permission to do this. This was not announced publicly. This was not entered into a public forum so these health issues could be discussed. They just secretly have done it on a worldwide scale of an enormous proportion, dropping hundreds of thousands of tons of this this product in the atmosphere.
Exactly.
The thing about it, it's irreversible. Once it enters the streams and the waters and the plants, there's no way to remove it. You know, you've destroyed massive amounts of the environment.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, when we get back from the break, I want to talk about how the deniers out there, the skeptics out there, are just making themselves look completely ridiculous. Hey, folks, don't forget to support our sponsors. They support this radio program. We're going to be right back. You're listening to Linderman Unleashed with Dr. Russell Blaylock as the guest on naturalnewsradio.com. All right, folks, thanks for staying with us. Dr. Blaylock, this stratospheric aerosol geoengineering is what we're referring to when we're talking about these chemtrails, and I love how you talked about the fact that when you were younger, you knew what contrails looked like. They lasted about, maybe a couple of hundred or thousand feet, and then they slowly dissipated, and what we're seeing now is just a structured blanketing of the atmosphere, and basically what comes up has to come down. I remember that old song, and it's really frightening, because I'm reading some, in preparing for this interview, I like looking at both sides of the issue, and I'm looking at these skeptics, and they're talking about, well, these studies that were done, samples that were taken, they were taken off of aluminum-sided buildings, and all this idiot crap that they're talking about, and it's like, what aluminum-sided buildings are you talking about? Because what I'm seeing is they're taking it out of one of the tributaries of Lake Shasta, off the snow caps of the snow-capped mountain of Mount Shasta. They're taking it out of the bark of trees that have died from aluminum toxicity. This is all, I mean, so blatantly real. I just can't believe that there are skeptics out there that can deny this.
Well, the skeptics usually are people who are involved with government somehow, and that's their job. Their job is to debunk it. The problem is that we have people who are trained biologists who are taking water samples, like you say, from lakes and streams. We have biologists from all over the world that are sampling it from the leaves of trees and plants and the fauna in Hawaii, in the Pacific Northwest, in Arizona. So they're doing it all over. All of them are finding the same things. And, of course, we have records of the levels of aluminum in the lakes and streams and vegetation that go back many, many decades, and so it's easy to compare. And what we see is over the last 10 years has been an astronomical increase in the aluminum, not just a minor variation, but an astronomical increase in the aluminum level. And, you know, when you look at it worldwide and you see the same thing, the skeptics just sort of fade into the world of nonsense. Most of the time when I see skeptics that are questioning what I say, others say, their arguments are so patently ridiculous, it wouldn't even make a good fairy tale. So they're very desperate and bending over backward trying to concoct some nonsense explanation. And one of the defenses I gave, I would watch these chemtrails, my wife and I would watch them, and I looked at them and I said, notice that the jets chemtrail now has stopped, and there's a gap, and it has started again, and then it stopped, and there's another gap. Well, if it's a contrail, that means a jet the size of a B-17 is shutting its engines off and starting them back up.
Yeah.
Well,
a little sputter
there. Jets can't shut their engines off and turn them back on repeatedly. So, you know, that alone proves it's nonsense. They're not turning them on and turn them off within a short distance. And then they give the explanation, oh, it's the coldness of the atmosphere. Well, you can see two jets flying at the same time. They're both large jets. One of them has a normal contrail, very short, very small. The other next to it is a huge trail. And so they're flying at the same time, same atmosphere, same temperature, same elevation, and yet their trails are different. And they're obviously different, tremendously different. And when these chemtrails go over, it produces huge clouds. Well, you don't see contrails that produce persisting clouds.
No, they immediately begin to dissipate.
After the jet is gone. You know, that's sheer nonsense. So, you know, their explanations are laughable nonsense.
Yeah, I mean, contrails, by their very nature, begin to dissipate as soon as they come out of the plane. And what we're seeing here is particles that are remaining intact and spreading. You know, it's patently ridiculous.
Sure, and they form clouds. You know, we've seen some days in which virtually every cloud in the sky is a chemtrail cloud. And they're there long after the jet's gone. I mean, hours after, they're these huge smudges of clouding. Well, that's not a contrail. Contrails don't last that long. And the other thing that's suspicious is when they try to get the military to give them, let them sample the fuel in these jets, they wouldn't let them do it directly. What they did is they sent them samples of jet fuel. Well, you know, that's two different things.
Yeah.
I want to know what's in that jet fuel. I don't want to have you send me a sample. You go down to the pure tank and, you know, send a sample. But you're not taking what's being sprayed into the atmosphere. So they're obviously, there's a lot of secrecy. They don't want sampling. They don't want you on the airplanes. And so you have to question, well, what's all this secrecy about?
Well, and is that how they're doing it, is adding it to the jet fuel so that it disperses? Or this is something I don't know. Is it a big C-130 or something that's got these huge tanks and the pilots are fully aware of what they're doing?
Well, I would suspect the latter. You know, even though a lot of the people suspect what's being put into fuel, I don't think you could put a high enough concentration in the fuel. It might interfere with the fuel and ruin the engine. I think they're separate tanks that they're spraying. And some of the photographs I've seen up close of the jets, it looks like separate nozzles. And so, you know, and the size of the cloud coming directly out of the jet is huge. I mean, it's as large as a fuselage. So, and I suspect that they have separate tanks that contain these compounds that are being sprayed.
And, you know, I've heard a lot of people saying, well, you know, you would have a pilot that would finally, you know, turn state's evidence or become a whistleblower or whatever they want to say. But, I mean, we've got pediatricians out there continuing to stick, you know, needles into young children left and right over and over again. They really honestly believe they're doing the right thing. And I think that's what we're going to see with this stratospheric engineering, geoengineering, is just the simple fact that these people have been brainwashed into believing that what they're doing is important and good for the environment.
Yeah, that's certainly a strong possibility. It's, you know, the pilots in the military, of course, in the military, they're told what's in those tanks and none of your business.
Right.
That's you know, out of your need to know. And, you know, if you've ever been in the military, that's the way things work. Everything's categorized. You know, you have certain information you're allowed, none of your business, and you better not even look into it. So the pilot's just told, you know, spray this, and it's, you know, he may be told it's for geoengineering, but the contents of it he doesn't know. These pilots, they don't know anything about nanoaluminum. They don't know about the neurological effect of aluminum accumulation in the brain. They're just told that this is protecting the environment and preventing a catastrophe. You see, the military's even been told that this supersedes everything else in terms of national security. That global warming is the greatest threat to our national security, which is sheer nonsense. But in the military, you know, like you say, you have a closed audience that it's easy to instill this propaganda. And they don't generally ask questions. You know, when I was in the military, people didn't ask questions. You're taught not to question orders. You just carry them out. That's your duty, is to push the button and release the chemical. What's in it and what's it for and what it does and what effect it has, that's really none of your concern. You're just following orders.
Yeah, that's one reason why I only spent 4 years in the military. Because I ask questions, and
sure.
they don't
like questions.
No. So what we have here, we have aluminum toxicity that is literally killing trees out west, is going to be, you know, we're seeing fish kills everywhere recently across the planet. I've got a list of fish kills that are day by day for the last like 3 months, and every day there's a huge fish kill, and I think it has a lot to do with this, which makes me wonder, Doctor. I think this is intentional, but not on the side of they want to change the environment. I think this is intentional to, get the population down.
Well, it's a very cruel way to do it. The other thing is the huge number of birds that are dying.
Mm-hmm.
We have millions of birds all in clusters that are dying with no explanation. Now, birds die every so often in clusters. That's known throughout history, but the scale of it today is just unbelievable. But, their intent, their intention, whether this is some nefarious plot to trim the population or whether this is idiots who really think that global warming demands this draconian policy, you can't prove, but there's no question that there is a very strong depopulation movement among the government officials, people that go higher than the government, people who make policy for government, like Council on Foreign Relations, and people from tax-free foundations that like Ford and Carnegie and Rockefeller foundations. They're the major funders. They're the policy makers. They generate the ideas of global warming, the solutions for it. And, of course, these same organizations at the same time are the leaders in depopulation. They've written enormous amounts. You can get on their websites. They talk extensively about lowering population levels and things that need to be done to lower the population levels. So it's not a secret. It's sort of like H.G. Wells said. It's an open conspiracy. It's there. If you read and dig, you can find it easily. So it's an open conspiracy to depopulate the world. And they're using numerous methods, things that reduce fertility, things that increase death rates, things that will kill off populations of the weak, sick population quicker than everybody else. So doing this, of course, the people who have pre-existing disease are going to die off a lot faster in large numbers. There's got to be a saturation point at which they're dropping so much of this material, polluting the atmosphere in such high concentrations that we're going to see a sudden increase in mortality, a sudden increase in these diseases that's going to go unexplained by orthodox scientists and medical experts.
Yeah, I think for sure that that's what we're going to be seeing. I'll tell you what, when we get back from the break, I want to talk a little bit more about this stratospheric aerosol geoengineering and ask you a question that pertains to the vaccines and this engineering project that they've got going on in the stratosphere. We're going to be right back, folks. You're listening to Linderman Unleashed, naturalnewsradio.com. All right, folks, thanks for staying with us. I've still got Dr. Blaylock on the program. If you want to check out his stuff, you can go to www.blaylockwellnesscenter.com. And if you haven't subscribed to the Blaylock Wellness Report, what's wrong with you? I've been reading it for years. Dr. Blaylock, one of the things I wanted to ask you is, I've, in my research and what I've read, and now my personal research, of course, and reading about it, the one thing that we've seen is the thimerosal was a big issue years ago, the mercury in the vaccines. And then what we found out was that the toxicity of the mercury was enhanced when it was put together with the aluminum. Now, what we're seeing here in the stratospheric aerosol geoengineering, what we believe is going on, and I know a lot of people are getting this from the government and what have you, but what they're spraying is aluminum and barium. Is there any correlation there? That does the barium make the aluminum more toxic, or is that something that people haven't really looked at yet?
I haven't been able to find anything, but we know that barium has pathologic effects on human tissues. And usually pathogens, when they're added together, they can either have an additive effect or synergistic effect. The synergistic effect...
There you are. Right next to the other guy.
Well, Ted, you talk too much, and you're in front of a camera too often, and they don't like that. You know, when I first met you 30 years or so ago, you came in to see my mother, I didn't trust you. I said, you were the FBI. And I was calling the FBI live because I knew that things were going on. Is the agency today what it was 40 years ago?
The FBI today is not the agency it was 40 years ago. And I'm convinced that the FBI today has been infiltrated by the Illuminati, as has the CIA, as has military intelligence, as has NSA. And I think our government's being run by the Illuminati, to be honest with you.
Well, the CIA has been often called the enforcement arm of the CFR, the Council on Foreign Relations, at 58 East 68th Street in New York City. It's the Rockefeller Bund, the Cassius Cartel, that owns the Federal Reserve. They are involved with the Bank of England. We're seeing the major operation coming from London and from New York City and Washington. Do you think that these craft are military? Is this done by, do you think Leon Panetta is flying out the military, or is this private contractors, possibly through Evergreen Air, that would be putting these dispersants upon us?
Well, I believe, since you have the Lincoln, Nebraska Air National Guard involved, I would say it's government. I don't think it's private contractors, but I don't know.
Well, we've got a different opinion here, but there are those who are watching this show right now who know there are pilots that would like to come forth. They're just hunting for a website that will address this issue, because a lot of these chemtrail sites are not addressing the issue. They're not pointing their cameras and the telescope and their ire and anger on the target. But we find out that there are some people who are coming forth in private. They're telling us at this base up here in Oregon. There's a woman who was at a bar, and she was talking to some of the guys, and they were bragging about dropping this stuff all over the people of the planet. What is the mentality of somebody like that? Are they like the guards at Auschwitz and Dachau?
I would guess the mentality of these people who are doing this, they're could be mind control victims, or I would say they're military, and they do what they're told. You mentioned a few moments ago, this fellow that was in a firefight, he didn't know who he was shooting at or why he was shooting at him. But the thing that bothers me is, don't these pilots know that they're putting death dump on their own families? Okay, that would bother me if I was doing this and dumping this poison on my own family. And I don't understand it. I can't understand it. I can't explain it either.
What are you going to tell them? Look in there.
I'm telling the pilots to come forward, and we'll put you on camera without using your name and your face. We'll blank out your face. Write to me at 6230 A. Wilshire Boulevard, Unit 6, Los Angeles, California, 90048. Write me a letter, tell me who you are, and I'll arrange to put you on camera. We'll blank out your face, we'll blank out your identity, and we'll go from there.
AIRCRAP, aircraft.
Aircraft, okay, ladies and gentlemen, email your information to aircraft, aircrap.org@gmail.com.
Normal. I think that there were a lot of jets flying that day because there were many going in the same direction, leaving parallel lines. And in subsequent days, I would see many jets flying where the lines were parallel, and there would be 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 all leaving trails at one time up the east side. And so they would move around the county in kind of a clock-like, moving around a clock. Later, we discovered from talking to people in different counties that they were looping out over the Pacific Ocean and then coming back in, and they were doing these huge loops. Discovered that from the size of one plume and watching one plume expand, that they could cover our skies in solid cloud cover in about 3 hours here in Mendocino County. That there was something wrong with this picture. I'd never seen anything like this in my entire lifetime. My mother, who was in her 80s at the time, I showed her, and she said, I've never seen anything like that in all the years I've lived here. Nothing. Began to realize that there was a brand new phenomenon that was occurring, in which jet contrails, instead of dissipating relatively quickly if you saw them in a few seconds, began to persist and grow. And NASA studies proved that they turned into man-made clouds that would change the climate, exacerbate global warming, impact natural resources. NASA, first of all, in the late 1980s, initiated a schools program for children K through 12. And they started in some foreign countries, and then they brought the program to the United States. And NASA began to have children starting to count contrails because they said that they're satellites and also that they couldn't count them from the ground. So therefore, they needed school children to do this as part of a kind of like a game. I think that they really began to want children to think that this was a normal phenomenon. And so in the late 1980s, this program started to go through. When we offered to give our videotapes and our pictures and called up NASA and said, look, we'll provide this because we've done day-to-day, time, date, everything on the pictures and on the videotapes. And NASA turned us down because school children, as they put it, were more reliable. That's what I was told. So then the second thing I found out by calling the National Weather Service, and I would ask them, are you on, you know, online, are you looking at the satellite? And they said, yes. And I said, can you look over Ukiah? And they said, yes. And I said, well, can you see a jet, you know, leaving a plume? And so I was on the phone with them, and I found that within a few seconds, if a jet leaves a plume and it starts to get a little bit larger, not real small, but a little bit larger, they can see the plume expanding. And we were talking about the same one that was going right over Ukiah, and the plume was expanding. And I said, well, how come in your weather reports you don't talk about this as man-made clouds or persistent jet contrails? How come you're talking about this as being a front, a weather front? And they said, well, that's the way we deal with it because it's clouds. So we look at it that this is being, you know, a weather front is coming through and this would produce these clouds. Well, I said, but it's not being produced by a weather front. The barometer is not dropping. There's nothing going on. I said, how come you don't just use the terminology? And he said, well, we just don't. Well, if they're seeing all this, why isn't it being reported? And it's curious because no weathermen will talk about it. If Ukiah was, the sun was occluded and all these man-made clouds appeared over Ukiah and covered the whole thing after 3 hours, they would say, well, it was a front, but you could look to the west and there was no cloud, and there was, the barometer hadn't dropped. There was no cloud front coming in from the Pacific. There was none from any direction. And yet we were covered over in this man-made clouds and things. Hey, where we talk about geoengineering. The interesting part of geoengineering is that it's now being proposed as a way to put particulates in the atmosphere so that we can stop the direct sunlight from reaching the Earth. It means that they could add particles, iron particles to the ocean. That's another form of geoengineering. In other words, when you have jets that change the climate, that's another form of man-made geoengineering. So geoengineering means something that you're going to do in the atmosphere that would not normally be happening on any normal type of basis. In other words, a volcano would be normal. The particulates coming up from a volcano, for example, would be a normal phenomenon, and then we would take whatever consequences comes from that. However, when you start taking and talking about, as Holdren is, he's Obama's science advisor, talking about taking care of global warming, in other words, by putting particles in the air, like sulfur or some other particles, then that means that we're going to take some action where we're going to try to interfere with some normal processes that are going on. And the problem with this, for example, with sulfur, is that sulfur, in the sense of it, we took it out of diesel fuel in California in 2006, and we said we have to clean it up because kids get asthma from sulfur, lots of health problems associated with too much sulfur in diesel fuel. We take it out of diesel fuel, and then someone says, comes along, like Paul Crutzen, and he says, we're going to put it up in the atmosphere to obscure the sunlight, so less sunlight reaches the Earth, and therefore that will cool us down. But what about the health effects? If you have to take it out of diesel fuel, then my question is, why are you going to put up something that's not helpful into the atmosphere and try to change the process that we live under? And that's what geoengineering is. And you can look at every drinking water test taken since 1972 in the state of California. I cannot tell you how many tests this amounts to, because every month, every week, they're taking tests all the time, all over the state, different utilities, different districts. I began to look at, was there anything showing up in all the drinking water spikes across California on a pretty consistent level? Initially, I looked for things like barium, aluminum, manganese, magnesium, calcium. I looked at what the pH of the water was to see if I could find any blips in pH. But what I discovered was that during the course of the year, starting in 1990, no less, that the water sources were all registering unusual spikes. Now, they weren't spiking just alone. almost every water test in the state of California was showing spikes in a certain year and a certain month for certain of these chemicals. Somebody somewhere was beginning to use inordinate amounts of arsenic, barium, aluminum, calcium, manganese, magnesium, and that all of these things, lead, iron, were all spiking at the same time. How can you have them spiking in the same time across the entire state of California when prior to the 1990s, and they were testing for these chemicals prior to the 1990s, that they weren't showing up in water systems at all? A friend of mine took and graphed every single water district, every single piece of data, and we now have a graphing program so we can look at any water system in California, and we can determine if they were spiking in unison with any other water system across the state of California. It took 300 hours to write a program to do this. The government has not expressed any interest, nor have elected officials, in actually putting the subject to rest by testing these plumes either. So what they do is NASA, NOAA, a lot of studies, university studies, they look at these plumes and say, yes, these are man-made clouds. They don't say how they turn into man-made clouds, if it's chemical or whatever. And then they discuss the fact that in these clouds that it's causing certain types of problems, covering us in cloud cover, dimming the sun, and then it's changing our climate and negatively impacting natural resources. A jet would fly in leaving a contrail, and then all of a sudden you'd see this huge burst, no contrail leaving, but you would get this kind of configuration, and I go, well, what happened here? Why did this create a burst which then expands for miles and miles and miles over the sky above us? And why would this part of the trail turn into this type of configuration? So this was odd. What happens? Why would you get different types? And so the standard answer is, well, there's different atmospheric conditions. But then we found that one jet would lay a short contrail, another jet right behind it would be leaving one that turned into a huge plume, another one would leave white haze. So we're saying it can't be just atmospheric conditions, there has to be something else going on. Then we saw X's and stop and goes, where a jet like this would leave a plume and then all of a sudden it would stop. What we see from the ground is we'll see a plume and then it expands. And the satellite pictures do show, and I have a lot of them, other people have a lot of them, we've seen them, do show the contrails and they show the cross-hatching. They show that they're expanding. You can watch them over time on satellite pictures and you can see as there's flights going around over certain areas that they expand. So we can see them. So they can see them from space, they can see them from the ground. So that there's no secret here about who's flying the jets. The FAA keeps records, Homeland Security keeps records, everybody keeps records, who's leaving the contrails, where these planes take off from because they have to file flight paths. It's going to affect agriculture, watersheds, water supplies as it goes this way, because you're going to be putting it in places that don't need it for private gain, commercial gain. Ski resort could have a weather modification over their ski resort, which might take water from somewhere else or snow from some other location. So we need to get Senator Kay Bailey Hutchison's bill, number 601, defeated this year, because it allows anyone to mitigate or modify the weather with very little definition of mitigation in order to do what? So, but all these government agencies would be allowed without congressional oversight or public consent to modify the weather. So what happens to crop production? What happens to normal climates? We can see it now. I became an agriculture crop loss adjuster, which meant that if there were any crops that failed in California for any reason, crop loss adjusters were sent by the state of California to go investigate where these crop losses were and why there were crop losses throughout the state. So I was traveling about 50,000 miles a year around here in this process. Then in early 2000, I began to notice that I would see jets and they would leave these little tiny trails, and then the sky would white out after that. And I was always irritated because our skies used to be so crystal clear and blue and gorgeous. And all of a sudden, you would see these jets, and I kind of thought of them almost as joyriding, and when they were, or skyriding, and when they did this, then the sky would haze over. And so I found myself when I was teaching tennis and being outdoors all the time, or traveling for work, that I was irritated a little bit about the idea that the skies were hazed over a lot. So that was the first inkling. And then flying that day, because there were many going in the same direction, leaving parallel lines. And in subsequent days, I would see many jets flying where the lines were parallel, and there would be five or six or seven or eight, all leaving trails.
I'm Ted L. Gunderson, a 27-year veteran of the FBI, who retired in March of 1979. At the time of my retirement, I was the senior special agent in charge of the FBI Los Angeles Division, with more than 700 personnel under my command and a budget of $22.5 million. I was an agent on the street for 9.5 years, and then I advanced administratively. I was a supervisor, and then I was number two man in Connecticut and Philadelphia, and assistant special agent in charge was the title. And then I became a chief inspector, and then I was the agent in charge in Memphis, Dallas, and the senior special agent in charge in Los Angeles, because I had three other special agents in charge under me and 24 supervisors under them. I have information chiseled in stone, documented, that the FBI had advanced knowledge about 911 and did nothing to prevent this from occurring. And this is atrocious, it's unbelievable, having been a former FBI agent myself. And it's very obvious that this whole thing has been orchestrated by the powers that be at the highest level of our government, and I want the world to know about it. The minute I saw the planes fly in to the tower on television, live as a matter of fact, the question I had in my mind was, there is no way, absolutely no way, that somebody could skyjack four planes, 20 people skyjack four planes, in this case 19 individuals, and our government would not know about it in advance. We have, the U.S. government, the most advanced intelligence techniques of anybody in the world, and you'll never convince me we didn't have advanced knowledge about what was going on. We saw the airplanes go in, and it's also a question about whether they're remotely controlled. I don't know about that. I hate to comment on something where I have no documentation, but there's much more to this story than has come out so far. You will never in a million years convince me that those buildings, those towers, collapsed because those planes hit them. I'm confident that they were imploded. As a matter of fact, there were seismograph readings from the basement, two of them, about the time that the buildings collapsed. There were also molten steel that was in the basement, which is a very high temperature for melting steel. And those planes hit above the 80th floor, so there's no way that airplane fuel could have dropped down that low. Also, there were fires that burned in the basement for some 100 days afterwards. So there's some implication. There's some finagling. There's some maneuvering, as far as I'm concerned. And there are many, many more people involved in this than these so-called skyjackers and terrorists. The anti-terrorism legislation was written back in the middle 1980s under the George Bush Sr. administration. A female Department of Justice attorney, who was one of the authors, made the statement publicly, before this passes Congress, people have to be killed. Now, if we fast forward to a World Trade Center car bombing in February 1993, at that time, the FBI had a 43-year-old former Egyptian Army officer as an informant who was in with the terrorists. He was commissioned by the terrorists to put the bomb together. He went to his FBI superiors, we're going to use a dummy bomb, right? And they said, no, we're going to use a real bomb. So the FBI not only knew in advance that they were going to bomb the World Trade Center, they furnished the ingredients for the bomb, which is absolutely unbelievable that they could get away with this. What's unbelievable about it is this was actually printed in the New York Times on October 28, 1993. But they got away with it. And if I was a congressman or senator, I would demand an investigation. Why would the FBI furnish the ingredients for the bomb that brought down or that had damaged the World Trade Center in February 1993? We had six people killed there. We had 1,000 people injured. We had a total of six citizens who died in the February 1993 World Trade Center car bombing. We had $1,000 worth of 1,000 individuals were injured. We had $500,000 in damage. But there weren't enough people who died to pass the anti-terrorism legislation. So now we fast forward to April the 19th, 1995, Oklahoma City bombing. We had 169 people who died, probably 169 because there was one leg they never did identify. And a year later, the anti-terrorism legislation passed. Now, it wasn't tough enough. I can't prove that there were explosives that were placed in the World Trade Center in the 911 situation. However, from what I've seen, an expert on explosions from Albuquerque, New Mexico, who worked for the government as under government contract, stated immediately afterwards that the buildings were imploded. And then he retracted his statement and said, well, maybe they were, maybe they weren't. But basically, now he's saying that they weren't imploded. But other experts who have looked at the pictures say that the buildings were imploded. I think that in order to implode those buildings, there had to be implications, government implications or involvement in placing these charges. I mean, that was a tremendous project. I don't know how many people would be involved in that. Going back to Oklahoma City, an inside investigator told me there were at least 11 other people involved in the Oklahoma City bombing. Now, if you have 11 other people involved in Oklahoma City, you're going to have three or four times that involved in the World Trade Center situation.
This is a national emergency. Important details will follow. The emergency alert system has been activated.
Ladies and gentlemen, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people. For I have complete confidence in the response and dedication of our citizens whenever they are fully informed.
This video is based upon our research into the power structure behind the push for global government. The formation of a global government would require the cooperation of a large group of people from many nationalities and backgrounds. An organizational structure would be required to guarantee fairness, establish hierarchy, and avert betrayal. Such an organization would need to demonstrate a rich history of trust and cooperation between members. Prevailing thoughts on this subject are that such an organization would have its roots in Zionism, Satanism, or Freemasonry. Let us first consider Zionism, which seems an unlikely choice for the following reasons. The unfolding world government requires the full cooperation of many different ethnic groups. However, history has shown that different ethnic groups rarely trust each other enough to willingly allow one ethnic group to dominate the others and lead them in a particular direction. For instance, you wouldn't find early Irish American immigrants handing over the reins of power to Italian American immigrants or Jewish American immigrants, and vice versa. The flaunting of ethnic differences immediately sets people at odds with each other. Typically, they do not form close bonds and higher levels of trust. For a Zionist world government to work, many different ethnic groups would need to empower a tiny group of Zionists, most of whom are Jews, and in essence relinquish their destiny to this highly ethnic group. As many of you are aware, Zionism is a nationalistic idea which supports a Jewish nation-state and the territory defined as the Land of Israel. Pro-world government ethnic groups in China, India, and Pakistan would have to buy into Zionism to a large extent and base their trust upon relationships emanating from such a belief. And if you believe that Zionists are dominating and controlling the largest Eastern nations, it is important to consider that countries such as China, India, and Pakistan have sizable nuclear arsenals. Could these nations be bullied into submission by a scant few followers of Zionism? And if they could, would the leaders of these Eastern nations continue to enthusiastically support the idea of world government and champion a global banking structure run by a dominant group of Zionists? Speaking from a purely historical standpoint, it remains highly unlikely. And yet, the leaders of the Eastern nations are in full support of the emerging world government and its banking structure. Some say that Freemasonry is controlled by Zionists. If this were the case, Freemasonry would surely be forced to carry out the agenda of Zionism. And because the agenda of Zionism is very particular to Israel, it would be obvious to all ethnic groups within Freemasonry that an agenda of Israeli favoritism was being carried out. And so we would arrive back at the problem of Zionism's unlikely ability to unite different ethnic groups under a world government. Do not misunderstand our position. We feel that Zionism is a legitimate problem. We realize that Israel receives special treatment from many countries. And we are fully aware that Israeli agents helped carry out the 9/11 false flag attacks. However, we are not convinced that Zionism is the root of world government. There is a good possibility that many globalists are pretending to be Jews and/or Zionists so they can hide behind the anti-Semitic defense. Furthermore, real Jews and Zionists who advocate world government are likely utilizing the anti-Semitic defense as well. Using sympathy to gain support has worked wonders as a psychological operation, and we see no reason that those behind a world government would not employ such a tactic. In our quest to uncover the root of global government, the next possibility we might consider is Satanism, which has its roots in the Abrahamic religions of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Although Satanism has come to encompass a variety of New Age philosophies, it can never truly escape the confines of the religious structure from which it sprang. Surely there have been some moderately successful attempts to morph Satanism into atheism, but because its origins lie in the Abrahamic religions, it does not easily translate into other world religions and belief systems. Therefore, it is unlikely that a belief in Satanism would unite a Chinese Taoist, Japanese Buddhist, or Indian Hindu under the banner of world government. However, many world leaders with these Eastern religious backgrounds are deeply involved in the push for a world government. These men and women could be hiding a satanic belief, but again, it remains unlikely. So, which organization assures its members that they will not be betrayed at some point in the future, or hung out to dry like so many Middle Eastern despots? Our third option is Freemasonry. Unlike the last two possibilities, modern Freemasonry is an all-inclusive organization. Atheists are permitted to join through the Grand Orient de France branch of Masonry. Other Masonic lodges merely require the belief in any supreme being. Freemasonry spans a variety of ethnic groups. Historically, it has fostered trust and cooperation between members of different cultures, races, and religions. There are Masonic lodges in many parts of the world, including Europe, the Middle East, China, India, the Americas, and Africa. Lodges even exist within the military hierarchy of many countries. For instance, the U.S. government allows Masonic lodges within all branches of the military. Masonic symbols and landmarks are strewn across almost every continent. From the Masonic obelisks in Israel, Paris, Washington, D.C., Vatican City, and London, to the Freemason Rothschild-funded Israeli Supreme Court with its massive Masonic pyramid complete with an all-seeing eye at the pinnacle, to the Masonic Temple in Forest Hills, Ohio, which was made possible by Rockefeller estate donations, to the lodges located within the former British colonies of Hong Kong and India, to the Masonic layout of Washington, D.C., the Mason-donated Statue of Liberty, and the symbology on American money itself. No one can deny that Freemasonry has infected almost every country on the planet. Based upon such criteria, Freemasonry could easily be the organization behind the push for world government. There is also abundant historical evidence that the Freemasons have used their power for nefarious purposes. Freemasons were behind the murder of William Morgan, the Jack the Ripper murder cover-up, the French Revolution, the plot to kill Archduke Ferdinand, plans for world wars, judicial and police corruption in the UK, and the mafia-related activities of the P2 Masonic Lodge, to name a few. Interestingly enough, the ruling body of Freemasonry never accepts responsibility for any wrongdoing. Instead, they devote all of their energies to deflecting bad press and denying involvement in any activity deemed harmful to the organization. Masons have proven to be some of the most accomplished liars on the face of the earth. Freemason oaths to aid and assist any distressed Freemason and never reveal anything related to the Brotherhood when given under a Masonic sign, except in matters of murder or treason, are mostly to blame for their numerous deceptions. It is important to remember that Freemasons did absolutely no charitable work until after Freemasonry was banned in several U.S. states around the year 1830 for the organization's involvement in murder and conspiracy. During this time, American Freemasons essentially went into hiding and voluntarily closed lodges to avoid condemnation from a rightfully angry citizenry. In 1870, the Freemasons quietly reemerged and created the Shriners, whose focus was to be fun, fellowship, and charity. The Shriners branch of Freemasonry was designed to put a good face on the recently besmirched organization, and nothing more. Today, the Freemasons continue with their nefarious plans, while using the Shriners Children's Hospital as a defense mechanism. In the end, this strategy is no different than the mob operating a soup kitchen to garner support. It is both deceptive and pathetic. Based upon years of research and a careful process of elimination, we are now confident that Freemasonry is the driving force behind a world dictatorship. We are also convinced that there are no good Freemasons. All members are fully aware of the organization's many trespasses over the centuries, as well as their treacherous oaths, yet they refuse to resign. Unlike most taxpayers who only pay a fraudulent government to avoid lengthy prison sentences, all members of Freemasonry willingly donate money to the Freemason organization and are therefore complicit in the activities of the whole. We encourage the viewer to produce anti-Masonic videos, websites, and spread this message by word of mouth. You may also wish to hold protests outside your local lodge. Freemasons hate bad publicity and they deserve every bit of it. Your hard work and dedication can bring about the downfall of the abominable Freemason Mafia. We are seeking a worldwide ban against Freemasonry and life sentences for all 5 million or so members who refuse to resign. A Masonic database of names and faces must be compiled. These men and women must not escape justice.
called the death panel, and you're not supposed to have that discussion.
Anthony Gates actually brags he's doing God's work. The boss of Goldman Sachs said exactly the same thing while sending millions into starvation. What the heck is going on?
His father was one of the main grandfathers of the whole entire eugenics movement here inside the United States, and it's still going strong today.
My dad was head of Planned Parenthood, and it was very controversial.
And Bill Gates is here once again pushing the GMOs and everything else that is also reducing the population, because that's what he says. If we do a good enough job with vaccinations and everything, we'll be able to reduce the population. The polio vaccines now are the number one cause of polio. There's no question that Bill Gates is not doing God's work. And if he is doing God's work, I would ask, which God?
Yeah, how have we moved to open plans to take away our water, hoarding food, and population controls?
They speak to us as if we are people.